What is going on, everybody? Welcome back to an all-new episode of TAETRO Talks. Thank you for joining me today. I'm really excited for today's show. We have a great guest, and I see a few of you already chatting here. So thank you all for tuning in on this fine Tuesday. I hope you all are well. If you don't know, TAETRO Talks is a part of 343 TV, which is daily live streaming from 343 Labs, an electronic music production school based in New York, Berlin, and online. So wherever you are in the world, really. And you all should check them out. If you're not going to check out a course at 343labs.com, at least tune in to one of the other shows during the week at youtube.com/343labs, because there are some amazing shows taught by like Ableton Certified Trainers, like dolltr or Claire Marie Lim, who we've talked to on this show before, who's really cool, does a lot of the same stuff that I do and more. Beatport charting producer Lewis Beck, who has a show on Wednesdays, that's tomorrow. Max Wild, who does Theory Thursdays, Production Basics on Fridays, Techno on Saturdays. It's crazy. There's tons of shows. And 343 Labs is so close to 6,000 subscribers on YouTube. So if you could go, I see you all in my chat. Thank you all very much for being here. But also just open another tab. Go to youtube.com/343labs and click the subscribe button. Turn on notifications so you can tune into all the other cool live streams that are there. But yes, I'm excited for today. I'm excited that you all are already here and chatting. It seems like y'all are excited for our guest today. I want to say hello to SK, Delirium, what's going on? Hey, my mom and dad are in the chat as usual. Thanks, mom and dad. Nishark is here. Bueno, hello. Soaring Skies, Parrish, Chrono, what's going on? Ray Calvin, Fred, David. I'm going to try to rattle off all these names and not miss anybody. Carissa, hello, hello. Lavoyo, hello, welcome. Muka Thyro, I think I'm saying that right. Yossi Oren, hello. Ramses, or Rasmus, I should say. Hello, thank you all for being here. I'm so stoked for the show today and to be here chatting with all of you. I guess without further ado, we should talk about our guest, but before we do that, I figure let's play a little clip. So today we've got Laura Escude on the show, and I'm very excited. She's had this amazing career. She does so many things. I can't even explain it all. So I want to get into showing the clip, and then we'll get into actually talking to Laura. So check out the clip, and then we'll be with Laura in 1 minute. Welcome to the show. Thank you so much for being here today.
Thanks for having me. Oh my gosh, this is such an honor. I love your channel. I love everything that you do. And
No.
Love all the folks here in the chat.
Yes, the community is great, but it's like an honor for me to have you on my show. So I'm really excited to have you here today. And everybody just saw this epic clip, your 2019 performance highlight reel, which was, it's amazing to see you like rocking out on stage and doing so many things. And one of the ways I like to start these interviews with folks is by asking, like, how do you define yourself as an artist, as a creative, as a musician? Because you, like a lot of the other guests I've interviewed, do so many things, like live performance design, you're an artist yourself, you're an educator. But I would love to hear from you, like, how do you define, like, when somebody asks you, oh, what do you do? Like, what do you tell them?
I said that I'm an artist, entrepreneur, and live show designer.
That's perfect. That's a perfect, yes. Like three-tier thing.
And then as an artist, I'm a one-woman future classical orchestra.
You're the whole orchestra. I love that definition. That's amazing.
Yes, one woman.
Yeah. Yes. You've done, I just want to get into all the things, but I think I want to start with, like,
yeah.
You're kind of like a pioneer in this electronic music scene and doing all the things that you do, in that a lot of the things that you do didn't exist like probably when you were figuring out how to do them, when you were learning about them, when you were going into this career pathway. So I'm very curious to know, like, your beginnings in music. Like, I know obviously you play the violin. So was that kind of like your entry point into music?
Yeah, it was. I started playing violin when I was six and just fell in love with the instrument and did the whole classical music thing and was playing in orchestras and, you know, going to summer camp and all the things.
Very traditional.
And then very traditional. Yeah. I mean, I remember, like, you know, I'm 41. So I remember when I heard Dave Matthews Band in high school, you know, that was like crazy for me because they had the Boyd Tinsley, like the violinist, the fiddler guy in the band. And I was just like, oh my gosh, like, you mean that someone can play violin like that? I had no idea. I was just like very classical, you know? And so when I went away to college, you know, I just started getting more into like playing different styles. And then, yeah, my best friend's boyfriend was a DJ. And I was just like, what do you mean you're a DJ? Like, you play other people's music? Like, I didn't get it, you know? It was just like really foreign to me. And they're like, yeah, like, he plays at all these raves. And I was like, what's a rave, you know? And then, so then I just got into the rabbit hole of, you know, electronic music and like learning about all the different genres and then learning how to produce and kind of a random story. But like, George Clinton had a studio in Tallahassee where I went to school at Florida State. And my friend started dating George Clinton's son's producer. And so I just like found myself in his studio, like, learning how to produce, very early days.
That's awesome. And so much of what you do now is like, it's so, not, I won't say experimental, but like, you do a lot with electronics and blending the two. Did you start with like going heavy into like electronics and processing and things like that? Or is it more of like, you learned to kind of produce what you could already do? Like, you learned to record yourself doing what you were already doing? Or were you always going off in like an experimental kind of route?
I mean, I think at first I was just trying to figure stuff out. I remember I loved drum and bass at the time.
Nice.
And there was a drum and bass DJ that, you know, I was friends with. And I was like, hey, like, can I play violin over your DJ set? And he was like, sure. I never thought about that. Of course, for me, I was like, drum and bass is probably like the hardest genre to play over. I didn't realize that at the time. But I, you know, I tried. Like, I was just trying new things out. So it started with just playing over DJ's music. And then it was like playing with a producer. Like, producer's like, he was a DJ and he's like, hey, I'm learning how to produce. Can you play violin over my tracks? And then I was like, hey, like, what's going on there? Like, I want to do that too.
That's great.
Yeah. So that's how it started.
Nice. And
Dolchik, but it was super rudimentary.
Dolchik is in the chat saying Laura is the original certified trainer. And that's so funny. So like, maybe like in getting into all this stuff, like, where did your, where did the experimentation start with Ableton Live and how did that impact like your performance and you becoming the artist you are now?
Yeah. So I moved to LA about 2 years after I graduated from school. And I, you know, I came here, I went to some raves.
Rave
as
culture.
You, do, you know, exactly. I was very into going to, you know, to electronic music nights and parties. And, you know, I had this M-Audio keyboard, the M-Audio Oxygen 8, which is like, you know,
that's old school now.
If anyone remembers, it was like the very first like portable controller, you know, it's like tiny, you know. So everyone had those, like everyone who was making music had those. And at the time I was producing music in Reason and recording in Pro Tools. And so that was kind of, you know, my combo. And I just remember the keyboard wasn't working. I kept calling tech support and, you know, this guy was just like, I don't know why it's not working. And I'm like, yeah, but I paid, you know, $100 for this. And like, I gotta, you know, this is my only thing. I got it. I need it to work. And then I ended up running into him at this party and we were like talking with some people. I'm like, wait a minute, you're that guy like
that's
that I've been talking to on the phone who's like not helping me fix my stuff. And he was like, yeah, I am. He's like, you know a lot of stuff. He's like, do you want a job? So he basically just like kind of brought me into tech support at M-Audio. So then from there, you know, at that time M-Audio was distributing a really fledgling soft piece of software called Ableton Live. This is before Ableton was doing their own distribution. So if you got a piece of M-Audio gear, in every box was Live Lite.
Awesome.
And so we had to know what to do with it, because all these people were calling us like, hey, I got this Oxygenate.
Yeah.
I have no idea how to use this software. And I was like, well, I don't know how to use this software either. I better learn. So that's kind of literally how it started, is just like by necessity.
Do you remember what version number it was?
It was 3.
Ableton Live 3.
It was 3.
And here we are celebrating Live 11. Is there funny stories you can remember from like an early version of Live? Like any like jankiness you can remember of like how far, just to mark like how far it's come like since then?
Oh my God, there's just so many things. I mean,
I can imagine.
I can't even remember like pre Max for Live, you know, like what did we do before Max for Live? You know, like what do we do? But you know, like even though it was a lot more basic then, there's still so much that you could do with it. And I think just for me, once I wrapped my head around the session view and, you know, which is like the clip view for those of you that aren't familiar with it, but there's two views. There's the arrangement view, which is the linear view, and then the session view. Once I wrapped my head around that, I was just like, okay, I get it now, you know, and it completely changed my live performance, because before that I was performing with Reason and I had to open up a new set for every song that I did, right? So I had to stop and then I had to open it up, and it's very quick, you know, and it's very light on the CPU, but still it was just, you know, it wasn't ideal. And then I wasn't able to like run my violin through all the effects and do all the things, because now Reason you can do that, but back then it was just strictly MIDI.
So
I mean, I just think even back then we all saw like the potential in it, and just like seeing it grow and grow and grow was just so exciting.
Yeah, that's amazing. I wonder, where does live playback, live show design come into play? Because as you get more and more familiar with Ableton Live and production and building up your own artist persona and your own performances, when did you eventually take the step to like, oh, I can design these shows for like other people, I can help people like create this stuff for themselves?
Yeah, it was really by accident.
That's funny.
I was working at Ableton, actually. So after M-Audio, I worked at Ableton, and I became the first certified trainer, actually, in 2008.
The OG.
Yeah, that's why Claire was saying the OG. It just means I'm old. but I don't care. So when you get older, wisdom comes.
Of course.
That's what they say. in 2008, the economy tanked. Everything, you know, it was like really bad, right? Things were just really crazy, and I had to reinvent kind of what I was doing, because Ableton was like, hey, like we're changing the structure of the company, and you know, like your position's basically going away. But they said, well, we're gonna make you a certified trainer because you know you were here and helped develop it and blah blah blah. And so at first I was like really bummed, because I was like, oh, like I love working at Ableton. Yeah. And like, but then I realized they were building something much bigger than my position. They were building this whole certification program,
sure,
which made sense. You know, they didn't need me in that position when they had, you know, all these other people. So it was cool to be kind of like at the forefront of that and like help develop that and like build that. And, you know, of course, all these folks at Ableton, shout out Houston Singletary, and you know, Dave Hill's not there anymore, but just I had so many amazing mentors at that time. And so when I became certified, I was like, well, I don't know what this means. Like, what am I going to do with this, you know? And then I got a call from Cirque du Soleil, and they were like, hey, can you move to Vegas for 4 months and work on this show, Viva Elvis? And I'm like, you mean you're going to pay me to like move to Vegas and work on this job?
That's crazy. But
I had no idea.
Take me back like a couple steps though, because there had to be like what led to the call from Cirque du Soleil. Like it must have been like somebody saw your show, or somebody in the industry was like, oh, Laura knows all this stuff, and like connected you. Like what leads to that phone call? Do you know?
Yeah, so it was literally just like I was the only certified trainer.
Oh, wow.
Or one of the only ones at that time in LA, you know. Yeah. It was very new, you know. And everyone kind of knew me, you know, in the circle because I had been a product specialist for Ableton. Yeah. And so I was, you know, going around to all these states and stores, and I was doing demos, and I was kind of, you know, so I think it was like a combination of like of that and, you know, just being, you know, the person that people knew.
Sure.
So yeah, it was kind of a combination of that, but I really think it was like, they were like, looked on the website and it's like, okay,
yeah,
who's in the West Coast, and like, okay, like let's choose her. So that was awesome. You know, that was an awesome experience because, I really didn't know what I was doing.
That's
mind-blowing. I freely admit it now.
Yeah. And I can totally see that. Like sometimes you get calls for like jobs or whatever, and people like say, yeah, can you do this for us? And you kind of just say yes, but then you're like,
yes, say
I,
yes.
I hope so. Like, I hope I know how to do this.
You figure it out.
Yeah.
You figure it out, or you don't, you know. Luckily, yeah, I didn't get fired, but
what was the job like? What did it entail?
So it was, So Viva Elvis was the production. So it was basically based on Elvis's music.
Yeah.
It was very different from other Cirque shows because it was very closely tied to his music. So every, you know, trick or every like dance move or anything was very like tightly synced with the music. So it was just a lot of like, you know, crafting the music to what was happening on stage. So, you know, the other shows that I've worked on, it's like the other way around, but it was just very much like, okay, we need to make sure that all of these are hitting the right spots. We couldn't really mess with his music too much just because it's Elvis, and like, it's not like we're going to do like an Elvis remix or, yeah, something like that. Cause you know, we have the files from the estate or whatever, but yeah, I mean, it was just wild. It was like 4 months in a dark theater working with all these performers, just making sure that, like, you know, everything was synced and sounding good. And yeah, and then I left. So it was kind of like,
was it almost like,
I'm gonna just do this?
Was it almost like paid? I don't want to say paid training, but sometimes I think of gigs like that when it's like my first gig doing something different and something new. It's like, okay, I'm getting paid to do this, but I'm also like learning a lot about how to do something like this.
Yeah, I mean, I definitely learned a lot just by being in the room, and you know, that wasn't the intention, of course, but it was just, you know, but I did learn a lot from, you know, some of the folks that were there, and you know, another guy who became a CT later, and yeah, so it's just it was a cool experience. I mean, it was terrifying, but it was cool.
Right. And I imagine, like, yeah, once you throw Cirque du Soleil on your resume, that your like live show gigs, like, I'm sure people started lining up like to do more and more.
I mean, kind of, you know, I think at that time, because this was like 2009, mm-hmm, so I think that people were just starting to figure out that you could use live for, sure, those kinds of big shows, because it wasn't, you know, as trusted before that. I mean, it was like Pro Tools is the industry standard, and, you know, people were using Pro Tools and Digital Performer, but,
yeah,
live was still kind of thought of as this kind of baby program in a way. It wasn't just, you know, wasn't to the levels that, you know, these other programs, and like these other programs are very stable and blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
But I think more like as time progressed, people started moving over to live. And that was more of when I started getting my calls. I really think that, like, you know, when I started working with Kanye, you know, in 2011, that was really just like a relationship with someone, you know, a salesperson at West LA Music, which is a music store in LA. And they had met, you know, his engineer, Anthony Kilhofer, and said, hey, like, go work with Anthony. He wants to learn how to use live for the show. And then that's kind of how I got in, you know, into that, yeah, world. So it was more just like the relationships that I built and like the connections that I had that got me the jobs. I don't think anyone really, you know, goes on my website and is like, looks at my list of credits and is like, oh, like, we need to hire, you know, it's, yeah, more of like, this person says, hey, you need to hire her because she's awesome, or she knows this, or whatever.
And that's a really important thing. Yeah. I think for all the folks in the chat, for the community out there, aspiring producers, musicians, artists, creatives, like, it seems like networking played the biggest role in your career trajectory. Yeah. And it started from like, you know, customer support position, and then blows up to like doing live show design for like Kanye West and Cirque du Soleil and more, you know? So that's just a crazy trajectory to kind of reverse engineer, which is why I like to start these interviews like that.
Yeah.
So because people always see like the goal. People see like, oh, she worked with Kanye West. Like, I want to do that. Okay. But then it's like, okay, but before you do that, let's take some steps back and like, how do you get to that? But I don't want to gloss over that because I want to talk about your work with Kanye West and, what were you doing with him, and what was it like, how was it, like a major artist? Was he maybe the biggest artist you had worked with at the time?
Oh definitely. I mean, at that time, you know, I've been working with artists. I mean, I think I had become the sort of go-to a lot in the film composer community in LA, so I was working a lot of like film composers, and that was my first like love, actually. When I moved to LA, I worked at Hans Zimmer's studio as an intern for a little bit, and you know, did stuff like that. But like when I first got that call, I mean, it was actually 2009, to work with his engineer Anthony, I was like, oh, okay. I knew him, but I wasn't like, you know, it's not like he is now, like everyone knows who he is, you know.
Right.
It's like back then, like I knew who he was, but it wasn't like, you know, that into his music or anything. I mean, now that I go back and listen to all the earlier stuff, I'm like super into it, but I just didn't know the magnitude. And I think, you know, through working with him, I actually did also get to work with a lot of other very cool artists, like Bon Iver and, you know, like Paul McCartney, and, you know, just different folks like Jay-Z and, you know. But I think at that time, he would definitely was like the biggest artist.
Was it a similar terrifying situation? Like, you just keep putting yourself into more and more terrifying situations?
Oh my gosh. It was, you know, I just remember like the first show that I did with him was actually in 2011. So like in 2009, you know, I started working with them, and then I actually had to go do the Cirque du Soleil gig. And I was also touring with this other band, DJing for them, called Niaz. They're like a Persian electronic band. And so I actually had to turn down the gig with Kanye at first, which was really hard. Cause I was
can imagine.
Like, oh, like if I had known, like I wish that I could go on tour, but I just can't.
But it seems like it ended up working out.
You know, I passed it to a friend, Henry Strange, and he, you know, did some work with him. And then it actually came full circle because like he and I got, you know, I got called for this gig with Mike Posner, and then he got called back for the Kanye gig like a year later, and then we ended up just like swapping the gigs.
Oh, cool.
And so it was cool because it was just full circle. I'm like, okay, I'm back, like, you know. And that's why you gotta like, give your gigs to your friends.
Sure. Yeah, well, that goes back to the networking. It's not
you
just
might get them back.
Yeah, it's not networking for just opportunities. It's networking like with a community of people, so that's like another angle to it.
Yeah, totally. So anyway, that was crazy. My first gig was at South by Southwest in 2011, where like he had rented out this old like power plant building that was just like really in shambles. Yeah. It was like they were like, oh my gosh, like how are we even in this place? Like, but it was so incredible because it was like all of like good music, and like it was literally my first show. It was just like everyone from Good Music and like Jay and like, you know, Big Sean and like, you know, Justin Vernon and, you know, all these people showed up, and I was just like, oh my God, like this is nuts.
Let's really break down for folks, so like, what is the job? Like, okay, you're doing this South by Southwest show in this crazy power plant. It's Kanye, it's Jay-Z, it's all these folks. What are you doing?
So at that time, it was just vocal effects.
Interesting.
So auto-tune, you know, delays and things like that. I mean, he was still using a DJ for playback at that time, which is very, you know, typical until you get it to a certain level, right? And then you start wanting to dig more into playback. And I'll explain that more in a second. But at that time it was just really like vocal effects, auto-tune, making sure it's in the right key.
You're like
sure
just turning
delays
it on and off, like switching the key for each different song, like that kind of thing?
Yeah, I was like turning it on and off. I was, you know, doing, you know, pitch shifting with his voice in certain moments. Like I'd learned the music and, you know, just like would basically affect his voice in real time, pitch it down, do a little distortion, do some delays. So that was kind of my job for a while, which was just like messing with his voice on stage.
That's awesome.
So that was super fun. Yeah. Yeah. I remember at that show, it was so crazy because he had this like marching band from Austin, like a high school, come on stage. And during the rehearsal, they were, this is so rickety. They were shaking the stage so hard that my Firewire cable.
Oh boy.
Remember Firewire? my Firewire cable started, you know, came a little loose and it stopped working.
What
luckily it was in rehearsal. And so when I learned, it's my first gig, I learned you always tape down the cables to the laptop.
Yes.
You never know if you're going to be on a stage that's shaking.
With a marching
like
band.
This,
yeah.
With a marching band.
That's so funny.
Yeah. Yeah. So you just kind of, you know, learn things along the way, I guess. But yeah, and then later I started, you know, later that year, because Watch the Throne started. So
right.
Watch the Throne was his collaboration with Jay-Z, and they were like, we need someone to do playback. So I started, you know, doing playback and the vocal effects for that show. And so basically what that means is I just was taking all of their stems, all their music, and editing it for the show and playing it back basically night after night and having different outputs and being able to send discrete outputs to, you know, the people that are mixing front of house and monitors, the show can sound better, and folks that are in the band can have things like cues and clicks in their ears to play along with. They're playing keys or guitar, sometimes time code and things like that, although we changed the show quite a bit, so there wasn't a lot of time code for the lighting. But yeah, that was kind of the gig. So it was like, I just remember, you know, being in New York and they were like, hey, we want like a special like New York intro today. And I spent all afternoon working on like different versions. It's basically just like remixing their music and then adding, you know, like Frank Sinatra, New York in there.
That's funny.
And, you know, like Alicia Keys, like, you know, like all these kind of stuff and making little medleys and things like that. And then presenting that to the artists and saying, okay, you know, do you like this? Do you like this? And then they'll say like, well, I like, you know, the second one mostly, but it should sound a little bit more like this, or cut this song off a little earlier, or I want like a big boom crash sound effect right at this moment. Or, you know, so it's really just like, it's like it's like producing, but for live music. Basically.
It seems intense, like especially if you're night to night. The artist can be like, "Oh, I want this kind of intro tonight for this special occasion." Like that's a lot.
Oh my gosh! Well, we didn't do the same show twice, and you know, folks that know that tour, there was a song Paris, mm-hmm. and we played that song up to 22 times, I think, in Paris. In a row.
Oh, boy.
We'd literally be playing the same song over, and it got to be like the first, it was like, okay, well, you're gonna play it two times, and it was like, they're gonna play it three times, and then
you're
gonna play it four times, and like I literally had in live like 30 versions of the same song so I could count, you know, and be like, because people come over to be like, what number are we on? I'd be like, seven.
That's insane. That is insane.
I
love hearing that. Man, that must have been like just a crash course and everything, because that's still like, that must have been like live 8 days, live must have been still like on live eight. Like how was it running live
seven.
Back then for such, like for such a big show? Like how was it your main program? Like were you using other programs and things like that? Like what did it look like from that angle?
I think that was it. You know, I think it was eight because we just moved to eight. I can't remember when that came up. But yeah, anyway, it was seven or eight. And yeah, I mean, it was stable, you know,
yeah.
It was really stable. I didn't have a lot. I've never had stability problems with it.
Cool.
In shows. That's why I tended to use it. So yeah, I did, you know, I do trust it, and I did trust it. Although, you know, I do hang back a couple of versions now. Like I don't
sure.
like update right away. Yeah. And, you know, just because, like, you know, if it ain't broke,
don't fix
you know,
it.
Like, yep. I still rock Live 9 on my these shows that I do with artists like that, just because
super
stable. It's, yeah. you know, really light. It's light on the CPU. I don't need anything else. But yeah, you know.
That's interesting to know. I want to jump ahead a little bit further because can we talk about the Grammys?
Yeah.
Because it kind of like it all goes forward. Like you do playback and you play violin for the Grammys, right?
Yeah. So the Grammy Premier Band performs every year, and it's basically like the industry Grammy party. So, you know, you see the Grammys on TV and it's like the same 10, you know, huge artists, right? Yeah. But there's also like 100 other categories of artists that win for all different kinds of things. Sure. Right. So, the Grammy premiere show happens in the afternoon before the big show. And basically the band plays on each winner. So it's like literally like 80, 90 winners that we're playing on.
Wow.
So it's like, you know, best rap out, you know, like, best jazz album, best country, you know, all that kind of stuff, like best spoken word album, you know, there's just so many different things.
Yeah.
So, so I do the playback for that. And that one's interesting just because it is all live. Like, so there are, when you hear the band playing, there's a little bit of playback for certain more electronic songs for like the electronic categories.
Yeah.
But mostly it's just, I play it in their in-ears before they play the song, because there's so many cues, they need just like a little reminder, like, okay, this is how fast it is and this is how it goes. So I'll play like a little 30-second clip of the music, and then they'll play the song, and then I'll jump in with violin on certain songs, and then I'll jump in with electronics, you know, drum hits and different things like that, different songs as well. So
that's so cool.
That's a cool gig. I love it. Yeah.
Yeah. You're one of those people who, like, you would never know that these jobs existed. Like if you weren't having like conversations like this and you weren't putting it out there like the way that you do. So I think it's super inspiring because everybody, it's very obvious the artist route, you know, like we're all artists, right? We all make our own music. We all do our own performances. Like that's very seen. That's very like out in front. But I think it's so inspiring for folks, especially watching and listening in the community, to know that these things exist. And were you ever, it ties into the whole like taking gigs and then being terrified and just saying, yes, I'll figure it out. Were there ever any moments of like doubt, because you were really like doing this early, like before many folks were, like, so what was your mindset like to keep you going and to keep you in a mindset where you would say, I'll figure it out. Yes, I'll take this terrifying gig and, you know, I'll just figure it out. I'll try it.
You know, I think inside I was terrified, but outwardly I was really cool as a cucumber, which I'm not suggesting. Like, you know, there are pluses and minuses of that, right?
Sure. 'Cause
you do have to like really, you know, handle your emotional state, and, you know, there's better ways to deal with it. I mean, obviously, like, you know, people get stressed out. They do, you know, reach for substances or, you know, all different kinds of things. Touring can be like that. Like touring, you know, can be crazy. You're in a wild scenario. It's not real life. You know, it starts to get a little murky sometimes. And so, you know, I'd always just try to like kind of just ground myself, meditate, try to just be, you know, like, remember, like, like, I'm not a doctor. You know what I mean? This is not life or death.
Yeah.
Like, just those reminders, because it feels like that. You know, it does feel like that when you're in the midst of these huge shows and, you know, you're at Glastonbury and there's like, 300,000 people or whatever. Like, those are huge gigs.
Yes. And if, like, the firewire cable comes out.
If you mess up.
Yes. Yeah.
If you mess up, like, you know, everyone knows, and, you know, you could get fired. So, you know, I think I just like internalize it and also just try to be the best that I could and, you know, develop those relationships. It's like, no one's perfect. Like, yeah, occasionally, like, I would make a mistake. I mean, luckily I never made any mistakes that were like show stoppers, you know, that's kind of like, you know, the thing that you want to avoid. Like, never want to make a mistake that stops the show, sure. right? And so I didn't have any of those kinds, but you know, like miscommunications of things, you know, there's all these people, cooks in the kitchen, and they're say, you know, one person says, I want it to sound like that. You know, the MD, musical director, is like, I want it to sound like this. The artist says they want it to sound like this. Like the lighting designer says, well, it can't sound like this because I've got the, you know, and so there's all these voices and, you know, and if there's not a lot of hierarchy, because sometimes on different tours, you know, you get there and you're like, well, who's in charge?
Yeah.
You know, like who are we listening to? There can be like miscommunications. And then, you know, in the moment, especially if it's like right before the gig, everyone's trying to make these decisions. I mean, like I've been at the VMAs and like not known what version of a song that we're going to play,
wow.
like going into the show, you know, like having three different versions and like asking three different people and like, do you know what version we're in? Each one of them says a different version, you know? So it's like, sometimes, you know, you make a choice and it's like not what, you know, everybody wanted it, but it was like what one person
wanted.
But
you're making a choice. You're making decisions.
Yeah, you just, right. And that's the thing is like, you know, you kind of have to be that way. Mm-hmm. You know, like you do want, you know, you do want to listen to the team and that's the most important thing, of course. But like in certain moments, you just have to make a decision. Sometimes it's not always the right one, but you have to make one.
Yeah. And you're relying on your creative, like your creative mind to choose what's best in a situation like that, I'm sure. And also that's like a lot of times what people are paying you for. People are paying you to make creative decisions, I guess. It is a back and forth, but.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, you know, it's different with every like artist in every camp. I mean, some, you know, some playback engineers or programmers in certain camps are literally just like, they do exactly what they're told. That's it. And then some, you know, as I kind of grew and started like being more confident, I started making suggestions. I started doing different things and like, you know, and that actually like I did a bunch of violin work with Kanye and, you know, played on the Watch the Throne album and like did string arrangements for the Dark Fantasy tour.
Yeah.
And that was literally because I was like, hey, like, here's some stuff, you know, and not, it might not always fly. Like some people just want you to, you know, kind of do your job and that's all. But when I see opportunities, I'm like, hey, like, here's this thing. If you like it, cool. If you don't, that's fine.
Yeah.
You know? So there's like important. There's a balance between like being too like in someone's face, like, yo, like, look at me. Like I play violin too. I play drums too or whatever. And then just being like chill and like, hey, like, I do this too.
Because at the end of the day, if people are into what you do, they'll be into what you do, you know? Like there's no forcing it no matter how much you do it.
Yeah.
I'm sure we've only scratched the surface of like all those amazing things, but I loved talking about like the live playback design and all the big shows and stuff. I think that's great for people to hear. I'm curious about like what's going on now for you now that like nobody's touring, nobody's doing live shows, and I know that you are a great like you're all about community, also mindfulness, and like what's happening now that we're all in our own homes, in our own home studios, like what's going on for you now, like what are you focusing on?
So my company Electronic Creatives, we do playback for different artists, so I kind of built up that company and trained a lot of other people to go and be out on tour and do what I did. And like last year we had our biggest year ever and that was super exciting. And then of course the pandemic hit and it was like, oh, okay, like no shows. I also have been really big into education, you know, being a certified trainer and just always like believing in, you know, mentoring the next generation or, you know, those around me and my friends and helping them out and getting them jobs. And about 4 years ago, I had like an extreme health crisis. I completely burned myself out and decided that I wanted to kind of shift my priorities and kind of live life a little bit more chill and mindful and you know, less frantic and less all that kind of stuff we were just talking about. And so I started my transmute program. I hosted my first transmute retreat that year. This is 2017. And that was just really like the start of this whole kind of journey with transmute for me. And just, you know, that word being so meaningful to me is, you know, changing and moving from one form to another.
Yeah.
And I just really like identified with it because I just was like, you know, I want to like continue evolving. Like I want to continue growing and I want to help other people grow in their artistry and with their music. And so I kind of realized like, okay, I've been working with all these big artists, which is great. And I love, but also there's all these other artists out there that aren't, you know, they don't have the budgets of Kanye and, you know, like,
but they're still great artists and like they still do amazing work.
Right. And they want to like get into, you know, doing this kind of work on their own, like getting to perform live on stage by themselves or, you know, like with a band or, you know, doing their own thing. So I started my first online program, Transmute Accelerator, in end of 2018. And we've run it 4 times now. So we just wrapped up the 4th one. And so when the pandemic hit, I was already doing it, right? Yeah. So I just kind of focused all my energy in there and also like, you know, live streaming and doing the things that we're all doing online and stuff like that. But, you know, live streaming became such a huge part of Transmute. Because everyone was, you know, performing in their homes.
Yeah,
now.
And
so
it's
we
still
had a lot of amazing artists.
It's still fulfilling like the mission of what you set out to do, because us musicians and creatives still have to survive, even if we can't go tour across the states or tour wherever. Like we still have to like find some way. And if live streaming is the venue for that, then it's just as essential. And I admire that you still push forward with the work, because I can imagine it can be quite terrifying if in March everything comes to a screeching halt and you're basically in the business of live performance.
Yeah. It was literally like one day I was like, oh, interesting. And then like a few days later, I was like, oh, we've like literally lost every tour. Cause I remember when it started unfolding, people were like, I just lost my tour. Like I just lost my tour. And like my company literally lost like 15 different gigs or whatever. Yeah. So, but you know, the thing that helps with that is like everyone's going through it. It's not just us.
Yeah, that's true.
You know, but yeah, you know, it was just like, hey, it was a really good opportunity for me to just like focus on, you know, Transmute and my artistry and my personal brand, you know, like I've been building it up over the last couple of years and just love to like inspire folks and artists to create and, you know, be self-sufficient and empower them to, especially women, to come into this industry and become badasses. And so, I just kind of just super focused on, you know, Transmute, and started actually the Transmute Academy. So we actually announced that last week. It's my new platform. We've got a couple of free courses up there now. One is called Envision Your Show, and it's all about looking at different artists who are doing amazing things, their live performances, and dissecting what they're doing and envisioning what you might want your live performance to be like.
Yeah.
And then the other one is a live 11 course. So just put that
out.
It's a 90-minute free course on live 11.
That's amazing.
I know. Yeah, exactly. So those are the two. And then we are going to have some upcoming courses released. I'm releasing a course this Friday called Perform Your Music with Ableton Live. And it's actually aimed more at artists that are just starting out with live and just starting out with live performing. And and then with my Transmute program, we've got a couple of, you know, fun things in the works for 2021. So if folks jump into the Transmute Academy, join for free, there's no obligation to buy anything at all. There's a couple of free courses, but if you stick around, then, you know, you'll get to find out about some other ways to work with me and my team.
Sure. So, and for folks who don't know, I have Laura's social links in the description. So that's YouTube, Instagram, and her website, which I'm sure if you go to any of those, you will find out about all these things, and you can find other links that take you to the Transmute Academy and all that good stuff.
Yes.
We have that. That's all amazing. Do you think, like, as soon as this lockdown is over, whenever that is, in 3 months, 6 months, a year, who knows, we're probably going to have some of the best live shows ever, right? With all this stuff you're putting out and everybody just being at home designing their live shows.
Exactly. I know. And also just, you know, folks that, you know, that it's more challenging to like get gigs out there and you like fill a room because, you know, you're just starting out. Like this has been the perfect time to learn how to live stream, because it's like, you can have an audience, you know,
and they don't all have to be in the same place at the same time. Like, they don't all have to be in the same state or the same city or whatever. They can be from all over the world.
Yeah, and
you
can grow your fan base that way. Yep. And so then when you come out, you know, with your live performance later on, you have more of an audience, and you know, you can sell more tickets. So
yeah,
I think everyone's like counting down the days, even though we don't know how long it is, but like,
I just imagine that first festival
come back.
Yeah, that first time we all go to a festival again, like, it's hard to imagine, but
right,
it's gonna be great.
If you've seen that meme, there's like some meme, it's like, you know, when festivals open back up and it's like
everybody
all the
rushing,
kids just like rushing the stage.
It's gonna be amazing.
That's how it's gonna be. Yeah. Yep. Can't wait for that. I really can't wait for that.
Something you brought up a couple of minutes ago, I think it's maybe a kind of a good thing to go out on, because I look to people like you, like very high level performers, artists, like just professionals in this industry, and I look at your body of work and how amazing it is, and it's aspirational. But then I also hear you talk like about burnout and being mindful and things like that, and I wonder, it's hard to reconcile the two things, because you have such this amazing career behind you and you did so many amazing things, and I always wonder, like, is it possible without this like grind that eventually leads towards a burnout? And maybe like, what have you learned about mindfulness and staying like mentally clear, like even though you work on such high level stuff?
Absolutely. I mean, right now I'm just working on radical self-acceptance.
I like that.
So yeah, just like, you know, when we love ourselves no matter what, then you know, we start to create and make the best things possible, you know, that we could have never even imagined. That starts with just really loving yourself wherever you're at, you know, if you're just starting out, you know, if you're a year in, you know, like, even like me, done all this stuff, I'm still like, I could do more, you know, and I think at a certain point I had to like, just realize that, you know, yes, I can continue grinding. I'm, you know, very like to think that I'm prolific and like to do a lot of things, but when you take that time to kind of chill a bit and be silent and still and, you know, love yourself, and it sounds kind of corny, but like, it really is like the key to like everything pretty much. So when you take that time to do that, then the things that can come out afterwards are just like exponentially better.
Is it more creatively freeing to like really have that, the radical self-acceptance that really sticks with me? Like, how, what are some measures like people can take to be better at practicing that, I guess? Like, we don't have to go too deep into it, but like a couple takeaways.
I mean, I think just like, you know, just talk, you know, like talking to yourself, you know, like saying, you know, like, it's okay, like talking to yourself like you're a small child, you know, sounds a little corny again, but like, it really does help. Cause it's like, would you talk to, you know, your friend or, you know, your little sister, you know, like different people in a certain way, and like, you know, just like becoming more aware of like the way that we treat ourselves. And then when you're like, oh, like, I'm actually going to be kind to myself, I'm gonna be like nice to myself, then like things start to open up a bit more, and then you don't have to like try so hard, I think, you know, because you're just being, right? And you're just being, and like things are, you know, coming to you because you're in this energy of like acceptance and love. And I don't know, I think like I've been in that energy of like trying so hard and like rushing.
Absolutely.
And I just like, it's not for me anymore. But sometimes you kind of have to go through that in order to like come out the other side and, you know, be more like mindful and chill with your life. So meditation, you know, love it, you know, talking to yourself, loving yourself.
It's important.
Especially,
kind of
especially really
now.
Simple.
Yeah, we're all stuck and isolated, you know. It's never, I don't know if it's ever been
simple.
More important. Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah.
Laura, this has been a great chat. I'm so happy you were on the show today, and I hope it looks like chat has been enjoying the talk that we've been having, and I hope folks are able to take away a lot from it and really look at that career trajectory and like see like what it took, and even though we just scratched the surface on it, and then especially the points on mindfulness. So thank you for sharing all that. I really appreciate it.
Yeah, thank you. I appreciate that.
We touched on like Transmute Academy and stuff like that, but you want to point people in the direction one more time of stuff you want people to go check out after this interview?
Yeah. I mean, probably the best place is my Instagram, Laura Escude on Instagram. Just that's pretty much where I'm there. I'm not like really on Facebook or Twitter too much. We do have the free Transmute community on Facebook though. Mm-hmm. So it's just like a free place to hang out and chat with all of us and learn about nerdy live performance things in Ableton Live. And then the Transmute Academy is my platform, educational platform.
Awesome. So folks, go check that out. Laura's links are in the description, as well as a link to 343labs.com, where you can check out other courses from some certified trainers and teachers, like producers, musicians, touring musicians, all that good stuff. So check it all out. It's all in the description. Open up a bunch of tabs, and that's your afternoon right there. Laura, thank you so much again for being on the show.
Thank you so much for having me. It's been awesome.
Thank you all for tuning in for another episode of TAETRO Talks. I just realized I did not put my proper end screen thumbnail again, but tune in tomorrow for Lewis Beck with the Hybrid Home Studio. So tune in for that tomorrow at youtube.com/343labs. Thanks for watching.